I'm going to talk today about college students who play with balls in the real world, but that's been chewed up, and so I've got to come up with something else. What I thought I would do instead is talk about something that's also been used today a lot, and that's talking about Dan and his research and his inspiration and so forth. Now, that's a novel topic for me in some sense because I want to make the link between the goofiness and the novelty of his thinking and the pure genius of his science. It's not; these are not two separate categories. They're really instrumental. So I had the good fortune of meeting Dan in graduate school, as Bill Crenna just pointed out, during my formative years, post-puberty, of course. And we hit it off right away and had a lot of laughs, had a lot of fun together. And pretty soon we started doing science together and talking and having a lot of fun and generating implicit psychology, which someone graciously mentioned, and I'll give you the royalty check later, and then action identification theory and so forth. But I think if you had looked at us, as some neutral observer had come and taken a look at us back in the late 70s, early 80s, you wouldn't have that impression at all. You thought we were just a bunch of wise kids. We were running roughshod through the field. We were doing all kinds of things. We were creating crazy instruments. You may be familiar with some of these. If you're not, it's just as well. Hidden brain damage scale, great moment, so forth. The hidden brain damage scale actually came back to haunt us a few years later, as you may, or may not know. Dan, in 2007, was discovered to have a brain tumor. So in his characteristic approach, he wrote to me about this and says, you know, I lament the fact that we did the hidden brain damage scale. Why didn't we do the improbably large genitalia scales? I thought we had, but, you know. Anyway, so we had a lot of fun doing that. And, you know, this is good intellectual exercise. We generated a lot of fun, and we made ourselves laugh and giggle, which was not too hard to do in those days, actually. And we also did a lot of physical activities. We had played some Frisbee. This is Dan just a few months ago. He, actually, I don't know who the hell he's playing with. Okay, when I say play Frisbee, it's a little bit over the top because, as you can see, we're not really taking risk here. Okay. I did catch the Frisbee. That's the important point. Okay. And that was a lot of fun. We'd do stuff like that. On other occasions, we were kind of oblivious to reality altogether. I have no idea what we were thinking here. It may have been unconscious thinking. I think actually it was altered states thinking. But the statute of limitations are gone on that, so we're okay with that, I think. Okay. But then, apart from just the fun and frivolity, we were also doing a lot of theory construction, a lot of ideation, having a lot of fun talking and so forth. But the thing about it wasn't the usual sort of smart guy sitting, at least in my case, smart guy sitting down and doing linear, logical, deductive reasoning and so forth. It was more non-linear and emergent. They had these aha moments. And I was always amazed, and still am to this day, Dan's ability to take personal anecdotes, observations, outdated theories, philosophical comments, and liner notes from Elvis Costello albums. Somehow weave those together like a juggler throwing balls in the air to create a coherent message out of that. It was just stunning to me. But it wasn't logical. I mean, it was brilliant in some sense. But it was emergent. It had an aha feel to it. Well, that was always struck me as very interesting. Not just the ideas we came up with, but the process was interesting. And it occurred to me that maybe we were idiosyncratic and novel and out of the mainstream, but maybe, just maybe, the mental process really has this kind of emergent quality to it. It wasn't always logical and linear and so forth. There would be these kind of moments where just these little epiphanies would pop up and insights and so forth. So now I'm not saying that mere mortals have the cognitive agility of Dan. No one does that. But there might be something to that. That thought process really has this kind of a temporal dynamic to it that doesn't correspond to linear logic. So with that in mind, a number of years ago, my colleagues and I started looking at the stream of consciousness, which, as I understand, there's someone at Harvard who's picked up the William James chair on this name on this. I don't know who it is, but the William. So we started playing with stream of consciousness in a very simple way. We simply asked people to verbalize their thoughts about a topic. It could be themselves, it could be another person, it could be a topic, it could be an attitude, object of any other kind. And they simply verbalize in private into a wave file, a microphone stored as a wave file. And then later on, a few minutes later, they don headphones and they listen to the wave file played back to them. And as they do so, they're simply told to position the cursor with the use of a computer mouse to express their moment-to-moment feelings in that thought that they're expressing. So the screen is scaled from left to right, negative, if they had a very negative thought, neutral, about 500 pixels, to very positive, 1,000 pixels. And they simply use the cursor to indicate, as they hear each utterance, to express how positive or negative it was. So here's a person, oh, the hell he's saying. I'm great, no, not so great. Yeah, you're great. I don't know what I'm thinking. Anyway, so we get a lot of movements like this. And so what? People are changing their thoughts and so forth. Well, when you do this and you look at the trajectory, you find over time these graphs that show wiggles and moves and so forth. But what does that mean? Well, we thought there's ways of analyzing this to maybe capture the dynamics of thought in a way that really can't be captured in the usual 7-point response scale format on an attitude questionnaire. Okay? So we would sample the distance the person moves the cursor, or where the position is on that left-right dimension, 10 times a second for several minutes, usually 3 or 4 minutes. That's about all people can talk before they get bored with the procedure. With evaluation being expressed as the average distance during the judgment period, the higher the number, obviously the more positive the evaluation if you collapse over time. But we also looked at the volatility, or the speed of thought. That is, how much did the mouse movements change per unit time as they're thinking about the topic? In other words, did they stay static? Did they move a great deal? Did they move a moderate amount and so forth? And the idea was these two measures, these two parameters, are independent. We find that people can be very, very positive about something but show a lot of changes, or they can be very negative and be very stable, and all those other, there's only two of the combinations actually. It's possible to have these. So these are independent variables, independent parameters. So we thought, let's explore this and see how it maps onto some of the controversies out there in social psychology today. One of which, for example, is implicit self-esteem as measured by the IAT. We're all familiar with that. So we gave people a measure of self-esteem as measured by Rosenberg, which is a standard go-to questionnaire, and then we gave the IAT to measure implicit self. And then we had them do the stream of thought on themselves. That is, they would just talk about themselves for 3 or 4 minutes, and the screen goes black for no apparent reason. Oops. So we measured their explicit self-esteem, and we looked at how it correlated with the volatility of their thoughts, as well as self-evaluation. Not surprisingly, people with high self-esteem on the Rosenberg position the cursor on average very far towards the right side of the screen. They were saying positive things. I should point out, by the way, no one ever said, I like myself, I'm a good person. It was always lower level comments, but they would read into that positive valence. So say things like, I was a hit at a party last night. Or they might say, yeah, I made someone feel really bad last night, and that might be a more negative thought. So it didn't correlate with volatility. The explicit self didn't pick up speed of thought at all, but it did pick up the overall evaluation. The implicit self, on the other hand, picked up volatility and did not pick up overall evaluation. In other words, people, whether they're at the unconscious level, like or don't like themselves, didn't show up in the distance, but did show up in the rate of change. Those with more negative self-concept, as measured by the IAT, tend to show a lot of change between different states of self-evaluation over time. Okay? Well, that was interesting, but there's two, from a dynamical systems point of view, there's two interpretations of that. One is that implicit self-esteem is a competing or latent or unconscious judgment that's organized. That is, you don't like to think about it, but it's out there, and as you reflect on yourself, it pops into consciousness and so forth, and it changes the way you think. The other interpretation is that implicit self-esteem is a set of disorganized thoughts, okay, that disrupt the flow of self-evaluation. And I thought about this. Dan told me a number of years ago, and since published this study, about thoughts that are suppressed are often remembered out of order, they're disorganized, they're not very coherent. So it occurred to me, rather than being a latent attitude or a judgment, implicit self-esteem might just be a set of suppressed or fragmented thoughts that really aren't organized, but they disrupt the flow of thought. Okay? But with this measure, the procedure we had here, there was no way to determine which was right, so we needed a measure to identify coherent states in self-evaluation versus fragmented states. So that led us to a modification of our measure. And here I just want to introduce very, very quickly this concept of a tractor, which is a very popular notion in dynamical systems theory or complexity science. And a tractor is simply a restricted range of possible states in a system. So a system can move all over the place, but if it only converges on a small set of states, subset of states, that's an attractor. And when you get to that attractor, the system begins to slow down. The rate of change slows down. And the system tends to be a strong convergent. Convergence that provides for coherence and stabilization. So with that in mind, there's a couple ways of looking at this issue of coherence in the self-concept. A highly coherent person would have a single attractor. That is, they would just go to one spot and evaluate themselves. That would be a single attractor. Low self-concept coherence, on the other hand, is open to two interpretations that I mentioned before. Bistability, two strong attractors, that is, you're moving between two different spots, both of which are fairly coherent. One may be latent, the other manifest, but there's still spots you go to. Or the absence of strong attractors, just a fragmented system altogether. So when you think about yourself and you're incoherent in your self-view, you may just don't know what to think. So we wanted to find a way to tease between these two different interpretations. Self-concept clarity and uncertainty is a big topic. I've been fascinated with it for years, and I think it's ripe for reanalysis. So we have a study in progress, which is useful. It means I don't have to give you p-values. I can give you examples and say that's really true. So we're doing a study where we give people the Rosenberg test, a standard measure of self-concept clarity by Campbell et al., and then we have them do the mouse procedure. They verbalize thoughts about themselves for 3 or 4 minutes, put on headphones, move the cursor to indicate what's been represented in their thought process as they talk, and we have this MATLAB program that we designed to identify the attractors. Okay, so our hypotheses were that self-esteem, as usual, predicts valence. You know, high self-esteem would predict greater distance to the right side of the screen on average. But the clarity would predict the coherence or the attractor landscape. Okay. So here's how the program looks. Let me just show you a few subjects, how that works. The x-axis is the distance, with 500 being neutral and 1,000 being high, 0 being, of course, I hate myself. The frequency here, this is inverted to make the attractors look like gravity wells. Okay, they're really histograms, but it's going to look like it's going down instead of up. Okay? So here's a person with high self-esteem, they think great about themselves, and high clarity. They're pretty sure what they're like. It'll play a couple times, just get the point. Okay, so when you look at it statically over time and collapse over time, what you find is this person is converging over time on a very positive self-view. As they think about themselves, other thoughts pop up, but they aren't stable. They dissipate, and they wind up going back to this very positive self-image. Okay, that was reassuring. So clarity that looks like a single fixed-point attractor. Here's a person with low self-esteem and low clarity. Big difference here. And this is representative of people who have this psychological profile. Okay. Note, they don't go anywhere in the middle. This person's thought is either very negative or very positive. Okay? It looks like they have two attractors. It's a bistable system. They can think about themselves in very negative terms or very positive terms, but not in the middle. And you can look at it statically. You have these two attractors. By the way, we have techniques for measuring whether these really are, in fact, attractors and so forth, which I won't go into right now. So it looks like you have the unclear person with low self-esteem just simply has a bistable system. Well, is this true as well for the high self-esteem person who's unclear? Are they fundamentally different? No. In asking that question, I really answered it. They're different. So this is a person with high self-esteem who's not too certain what he or she is like. Okay? They don't go anywhere negative. It's always in the positive range, but it's not any one point. It's a wide berth or wide range of states within the positive range. In other words, when they think about themselves, they can't fixate on any one thing, but they just want to keep it positive. Okay? So it looks like, if this holds up, that first of all, this issue of coherence, certainty, and clarity is an important feature of the self-concept, and that it represents the coherence of self-structure. So if you have high certainty and clarity, it's very simple. No matter what your self-esteem is, you have a dominant attractor for self-evaluation. You always go positive. However, people with low certainty and clarity, it makes a big difference whether you have high self-esteem or low self-esteem. Low self-esteem people seem to have two strong but conflicting attractors, very negative versus very positive. But high self-esteem people have multiple weak attractors with a very restricted range, slightly positive to very positive. And this has to be fleshed out with, you know, statistics and p-values and all that stuff. But if it's true, if this holds up, this has interesting implications, I think, for social interaction, how people respond to social feedback, and so forth. So, for example, there is evidence that people who are unclear about themselves are very vulnerable to social feedback, but maybe in different ways depending upon their self-esteem. Okay, so someone with low self-esteem, they can accept really, really ugly things about themselves, but then they can feel really, really wonderful the next day or the next party or something, move back and forth. Okay, someone with high self-esteem who's unclear, on the other hand, is willing to accept things as long as they're above the neutral point. And this is kind of reminiscent of what Baumeister showed years ago with threatened egotism, right? That you have people who just really have high self-esteem are really at risk for getting really angry at people who diss them and don't like them very much. Okay, low self-esteem people don't have that problem. So, yeah, that's probably true either way. But high self-esteem people may be much more restricted in the sort of feedback they accept. Again, this sounds great, but I haven't done the p-values yet, but I think it'll hold up. I won't take it outside the college sample, of course. Okay. If this is true, and, you know, this way of thinking about how mental process works may be extended to psychological processes a little more generally. So you could talk about any type of psychological process in terms of its attractor landscapes. That is, systems could have a single dominant attractor. They have one way of converging and restricting the range of states a system can go into. You could have a multi-stable system that's capable of being two or three or maybe four possible states. You could have a system that's totally incoherent with weak or non-existent attractors. And again, there's other types of attractors we have talked about, periodic, chaotic attractors, and so forth. And if that's true, maybe that applies to social psychological phenomena of different kinds. Here we talk about self-concept. We've done similar research with social judgment. Social relations, maybe close relations could be discussed in these terms. So, you know, you track the affect and the change in affect over time in a married couple to get a sense of how stable and coherent the couple really is. They may be wildly in love one day and then at each other's throats the next and so forth. Or even intergroup relations. Right now I'm studying some conflict, international conflicts with some people at Columbia, and we look at nations that get in these intractable conflicts that can't seem to break out of it no matter what you do. You can resolve the issues that initially propel the conflict, they just can't get beyond it. And it could be because they've created really strong attractor basins that can't allow them to think of anything else. Okay. So that's our hope, is that we can use this way of thinking about psychological process, not just in terms of the valence, but also the coherence of the process. And with that in mind, the structure can be used to predict dynamics, and conversely, dynamics can be used to infer what the underlying structure had to be. So that's kind of the vision we have for using this approach to social psychology, is that all the domains out there, the topic, are really interesting, but maybe there's something more common, more fundamental from a dynamical point of view. Which brings me back full circle. I mentioned at the beginning the stuff that, you know, I was fortunate enough to experience with Dan back in the early years, in the late 70s, early 80s, and so forth, how theories are constructed. Okay? So where do theories come from? Okay? Well, there's a certain sense in which it's order out of chaos. It's not a logical linear process. There's lots of elements out there that begin to congeal or converge on attractor states. Dan was a master at this, much better than I was. He would take, again, anecdotes, personal observations, people walking down the street, his reflection in a mirror, I don't know what it was, just could be almost anything. And all these elements would be in play, almost like someone throwing balls in the air and making a nice pattern out of that, and create this wonderful, beautiful theory out of it. If you try to write the recipe down of how you create a theory, it just wouldn't work. It had to be kind of this emergent pop-up effect. But so with that in mind, and with the old adage that a picture is worth lots of words, here's a freeze frame of a theorist in action. Thank you.